Detroit is not an easy city to love. It has always been burning itself down. Detroit's 200-year-old Latin motto is, amazingly, more like a prophecy. It translates to, "We hope for better things. It shall rise from the ashes."
From 7 p.m. to 7 a.m., they had about 36 fires. So it was about three fires on an average in an hour. There were two firefighters killed. There were two people killed in a firebombing. So it was a busy night.
Isn't it amazing that in Detroit, that's a busy night, not a tragic night?
Yeah, I don't know if we can even measure things in tragedy anymore. We've lost so much. The city's been through so much.
Steve Neveling is a reporter who chronicles Detroit's many, many fires.
So some people just burn the houses down. Other people do it for insurance because they could never sell their home if they wanted to. You know, others just do it for fun. And they do it for fun because they know they can get away with it.
This city is now officially bankrupt, and its population is now down to half of what it was back in 1950.
It's a tough city. It's a gritty city. It's a city where people love each other. It's a hard city.
Even Detroit's holy places have been reduced to rubble. People here tell me they grew up going to St. Agnes's Church. It was less than 10 years ago that the congregation shuttered its doors. And already, St. Agnes is a ghost. Today, urban explorers like Nick Sortsy and his friends travel from all across America to adventure by climbing inside Detroit's decaying landmarks.
Yes, and nobody told anybody about it.
I just think it's interesting to go places that not everyone goes to and see stuff that not everyone sees. And I like history and stuff too, so it's just like people see this stuff, but they don't know it's there and what's in the inside.
The husk of the Fisher Automotive Plant is a favorite. This industrial titan manufactured airplanes and tanks during World War I and II. And then millions upon millions of Buicks, Cadillacs, Fords, and Studebakers. Everywhere you look, there's a shadow of Detroit's glory days at the center of the world's car industry.
Looks like an early 1900s car, and it's probably a GM.
All the assembly lines would go down, and a different part would be put on each car, and it made the way all the way down here, and then they would ship it out.
Most of the world seems to view today's Detroit as one giant scrapyard. But for people like Tim Alexander, that scrap is just the beginning. I meet Tim when he pedals by on an industrial tricycle that he's just refurbished. Soon, this will be the platform for a micro coffee shop on wheels. There just aren't that many jobs in Detroit, and so Tim is learning to make gainful work out of what's at hand, taking pieces of Detroit's wreckage and refashioning them into something new.
I started up in summertime. And we fixed this bike before it had all this great stuff on it. It's great.
Tim is learning his trade from the Brightmoor Youth Entrepreneurship Project, a youth trade skill training program conceived and supervised by Bart Eddy.
Many people would say, oh, there's no work in Detroit. On the contrary, there is an endless amount of possibilities in this city for the restoration and reclaiming of the city.
Bart calls this curbside economics. No task too small to galvanize industrious thinking. The first products Bart's trainees made were simple wooden signs like these.
And of course, the great thing about this is that
He's learned the basic woodworking skills, so he's getting paid for this job now that he's working on. He can make approximately $10 a letter on this. So he's got himself $60 right here he can work on.
Beyond the woodworking and the bike repair, there's also a community gardens project. And even a fashion micro-brand called DCH Apparel and produced just down the hall.
We're just trying to do something right for this city, pretty much.
And how does making t-shirts doing something right for the city?
Keeping the kids out of trouble.
Including you?
Mm-hmm.
We have to awaken young people to a larger dream. That's the dream, really, of the transformation of their community and what their city might become, could become. I love these kids. They're the only reason I walk through this door every morning. In the midst of the old institutions crumbling and falling apart, there's only one reason that I come through here. It's when I see the kids every morning. And, you know, yes, I do. I love them deeply.
Love is not a word that I expected to hear constantly in a place with as many rough edges as Detroit. But I heard the words love and Detroit together a lot. Even here, where Tim lives, in one of the poorest postcodes in America.
I love this place. It ain't all bad.
What it takes me a while to realize is that where I see a burned out building, Tim sees opportunity. He believes that the people that love Detroit can restore it.
I really think they can if they actually put the effort into it and put everything into it. The money into it, the heart into it, because, I mean, it's worth it. Back in the day, everybody used to love Detroit.
And it's not just locals that feel this way. Amy Cahurl's not from here, but she's made it her business to bank on that spirit.
What it means to make Detroit better.
I've never felt love like I felt when I've walked into this city. I love going to the doctor's office and the guy who's taking your blood is talking to you about baseball on a really human level. And I was like, if I would have driven 8 miles north, this conversation and this warmth never would have happened.
Amy runs Detroit Soup. It's a monthly dinner where strangers who love Detroit give other strangers who love Detroit money from their own pocket to help make the city a little better.
You get great people, you get great food, you get great communities. It's an amazing opportunity.
For a $5 entry fee, you get a bowl of soup, a crust of bread, and one vote. The vote is for which community improvement project should take home the door money.
These presenters get 4 minutes to share their idea. Afterwards, we eat, we share, connect, share resources, talk to strangers, and then we vote, and whoever has the votes at the end of the night wins the money from the door.
We have a master lock that is 50% harder than any lock that they've ever created.
One idea is to develop a better lock for houses in unsafe neighborhoods. Another is to buy the most disadvantaged school children clean, new uniforms.
To me, because I have a child, he's 8, I'm a single mom, I know how much it costs to buy uniforms, and that is a lot of parents in our area who can't do that.
And then two young men get up to present a plan to build bus stop benches with books stashed inside.
Good evening, everybody.
To make better use of the time spent waiting on Detroit's bankrupt public transport system.
Co-founders of Sit Under Detroit, we create benches that are made out of recycled wood. And it's kind of like this adaptable reuse that's kind of trending here in the city, where you take something that's old from abandoned houses and creating something out of it. So the problem that we saw with the
And it's this idea of a do-it-yourself replacement for the city's failing infrastructure that resonates with the crowd.
So congrats, Sit Under Detroit.
So, Kyle Bartel and Charles Molnar are handed the paper bag stuffed with bills.
We got $1,200, right? Is that what you said?
So, what's that? That's like 40 benches we can build. Sit on it, Detroit. Sit on it.
Hey! Detroit Soup has helped launch a number of good ideas. One was the Empowerment Plan, a social startup that's employing women from shelters to sew winter coats for the homeless. Coats designed to double as a sleeping bag for cold nights spent out on the streets.
There's a lot of people out there who sleep in the streets, and they'd be so cold, and it's so cold. And this is a brilliant idea. It's a simple idea. And I think about, why didn't somebody think about it a long time ago? That's what I keep thinking. Why didn't somebody think about this a long time ago?
Sharonda Brown had not had a job for 5 years, until she was hired here 2 weeks ago, straight out of a Detroit shelter. She thinks of this job as a gift.
It really is, especially at this time in my life, and my birthday's coming up. I'll be 50.
It's clear that small changes are happening everywhere in Detroit. But big changes, those take big money. But even that has started to come to town. Inside this old GM building is a company that's been putting a very specific question to focus groups across the country.
And asked the question, you know, if all other factors were the same except for price, one was made in America, one was made in China, and the other was made in Detroit, what would you pay more for? And in the end, Detroit won out. If it was just between made in China, made in the USA, they went with made in China. I think what's been happening with the whole Made in America stamp is that people are a little, you know, unsure exactly what that means. But when you say made in Detroit, that's making it specific. That makes it real.
The company is Shinola. They make rustic goods like leather-bound books. And they're producing the first watches manufactured in America in almost half a century. Shinola's watch factory is no small investment. The company is gambling heavily on the hope of successfully marketing that indefinable Detroit feel.
You know, I guess the best word I could say is Detroit has swagger. You know, it has many things that cities like New York have lost. You know, New York has turned into something very different than the grittiness that it had before, and if you're used to that, you miss that.
With these first faint signs of a resurgence, developers are now circling Detroit's prime properties, like this one, the lot of the old Packard plant. Steve Neveling is cautiously calling it a comeback. He sees the city's future as being one of both great opportunity and great need.
There's two Detroits right now. You have a Detroit where you have a lot of underserved people who've been living here their entire lives, and then you have a Detroit where you have a younger class moving in, a more creative class moving in, and they have more money. So it's going to take a long time. If we want to measure Detroit's success, we have to look at both successes, not just of the creative class, but also of the people who've been here for so long and have stayed here for so long and have been through the riots and have been through the fires and the murders and the deaths and stuck around.
There are big bets being made right now on whether Detroit is going down or coming up. If you glanced at any one of Detroit's streets, you'd have good reason to bet against it. But then you might miss the one vital thing that Detroit's relying on to rebuild, something it's always had plenty of. Detroit's got soul.